See you. On behalf of the family, the Hastings family, and Laura, I just want to thank you for coming. Welcome you for being here. Very special to all of us, and just a blessing he was in a variety of ways to us. We're going to welcome a lot of different people here. Obviously, people from our church, people from the community, from both the camp as well as Faith Up Spotify, where he served. Obviously, get many colleagues as lawyers as well. And if you're just really quickly, if you're part of the Bar Association as a lawyer, would you please stand just to recognize his part in that service to our community? Thanks for being here. As we get started, I just want to open in a word of prayer. Craig was very special to me. We moved here when I was in third grade, and we went to the same school as his kids did initially, and we would ride together to school. We lived close enough that we would drive together, and one of the ways that he was kind of just, he was always working on teaching you something or working on something, and so pretty quickly as we're driving along, he had a stick shift, and he's like, okay, you're gonna shift. And I'm like, what? He's like, yeah, you're gonna shift. Next time you're gonna go from second to third when I say do it. I'm like, okay. And so he said, okay, do it. I'm like, no, of course I totally messed it up. Stalled out. Like, okay, try again. Yeah. So that's the kind of guy he was. He was just always trying stuff, pushing you, and making you think and do things you weren't necessarily comfortable doing sometimes, but in order to make you a better person and to grow you. And one of the things we did going to school, we memorized certain passages of scripture, and one of those passages early on we were memorizing was Psalm 100, and we would work on it as we would travel in the car sometimes. And I think it's appropriate for gathering together, rejoicing in how God works through great. It says, make a joyful shout to the Lord, all you lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who has made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people, and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving, and into his courts with praise. Be thankful to him, and bless his name. For the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting, and his truth endures to all generations. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we come before you grateful, praising you, because how you worked in Christ's life to lead him to yourself, how you taught him of your Son, Jesus Christ, and how he then was a blessing to so many people in so many different ways. With his analytical mind, analyzing and giving wise counsel, and his fun-loving, joyful side, and just making life a lot of fun and joy for the people around him. And Lord, we're both missing him, but we're also coming with joy into your presence this afternoon, because you are still God, he is with you, and your mercy endures to all generations, and therefore it endures even to us at this time and this place. We know that we have eternal life because Christ came and died and rose again. And so we have confidence that even now, Craig's with you, looking forward to the time when we're all gathered together in the resurrection to be with you and spend eternity with you. And Lord, even though that day is not now and we're mourning Craig's loss, we just pray that our hearts will be lifted up in praise and gratefulness and thankfulness to you. In your Son's name we pray.
Lots of good memories. I love looking at the pictures. Craig looks so young. Laura loves to see you. Thank goodness. Craig looks so young. And if you didn't know before, you saw it in the pictures. Craig loved music. So it shouldn't be a surprise to you that in the program today, you will find several pieces of music, all good music. Craig also loved hymnology. So you get to be the first part of the program by joining me in a couple of hymns that the family has selected. will stand as we sing first, "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God." You'll find it in number 151 if you want to use it.
Stretch for him. He wasn't sure that he was going to be able to do it, but he cared so much about college students that he said, we'll give it a try. Well, it was the beginning of a wonderful relationship that I had with Craig through the years. I learned that Craig was a very good lawyer, but as he worked on contracts, real estate, and such, he was serious. The times when we really had fun were when his eyes twinkled. He loved working with adoptions, making new families, and working that all out. There was a lot of work to it, but he enjoyed that so much. We had fun, as we talked about, former college students that he had had even decades earlier, and where they were in their ministry, what they had learned, how they came back, how they took what they had learned and did that elsewhere. He absolutely loved to talk about that. One of the things that kind of flew under the radar a little bit is, if you knew Craig at all, you knew that he always drove old, beat-up cars. But what he did with those cars is oftentimes not published very well. He would take those and give them to somebody that needed them. And he'd go find another old beat-up car, and on the cycle would go. I had great times sitting and talking, discussing theology with Craig, talking about how that impacted college students' lives, how that impacted ministry, what ministry ought to look like, and had many, many, many hours talking about that with Craig. I will miss him. He was a good friend, great mentor, wonderful, wonderful theologian, a man of God in so many, many ways, and a person that really cared about people.
You know, in a lot of ways, that looking at Craig's age, is it 67? He was going to be 67 the day after he passed away. And in a lot of ways, we think that just seems too soon, too early. That's what I thought when I first heard the news, even that it was coming a while back. But, you know, thinking about it, really, we're on this earth to accomplish things for God. And when you think about the impact that Craig has had in so many people's lives, mine, yours, you know, he's lived 100 lives. He's accomplished as much as many of us would in 300 years, in the 67 years that he was here. And so when I was with him a couple weeks ago, we were able to see him. I shared these verses with him. It really made me think about Craig's life and how to think about where he was going and what was happening. It's the Apostle Paul wrote in 2 Timothy chapter 4, he said, "I'm already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure is at hand." Paul knew he would be gone soon, and he said, "I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. Finally, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day. And not to me only, but also to all who have loved his appearing." I first met Craig when I came here as a freshman in Bible college and visited Campus Baptist Church, and I was immediately impressed in the Sunday school class. Here's a man who looked at the scriptures with the scrutiny of a lawyer, and he asked a lot of hard questions of the scriptures, and he answered them with incredible intellect. And because of his wisdom over the years, he's been one of the first people I call when I needed advice for a big decision. I just love the way that Craig thought through things. And he had a lot of knowledge in a lot of different areas, and he was a great help in that way. My family was able to get very close to Craig and to his family, Laura. They're very special to us. When I was a freshman that year, they had an adopt-a-student program here for the students on the university campus, as well as some of us that were coming up from Faith. And so I got to be a part of this this lawyer's family. Oh, cool. So we did a couple things that first year. Not a whole lot. I was just some kid, punk kid that would run around. Then when my wife started coming to church with me, we were just dating at the time, but we would go over to their house in the afternoons, and on Sunday afternoons between services, have lunch together, things like that. And our relationship got so close that now our children call Craig and Laura grandma and grandpa Hastings. And I think some of them actually think they're their grandparents. But in those years that we spent getting to know Craig, one of the things that stuck out to us was his incredible generosity. I'm sure he probably bought us lunch about 2,000 times in those years. One of my first computers when I was in college came from Craig. I think we may have gotten one of those cars at one point. And I remember once thinking, how could I ever repay somebody like Craig for all that he's done and all the things that he's done in my life? And I realized I never can. The only way that I can possibly repay Craig is to follow his example. And as the Lord blesses me with learning, as he blesses me with the resources, do the same for other people, and I believe that's what he would want, is for us to take his legacy and to carry it on, and to strive to make the same impact in other people's lives.
The family's going to come in a few others to sing. I can only imagine.
Thank you. tolerance. Here's the thing, this isn't in the agenda, but Dad isn't really a doctor, so I'm going to take a panorama photo, okay? Because somebody rolled me away by just being here right now. The miles of travel, it's just awesome. So, Dad put a list of 7 pastures on a sheet, so let's do it all. And so we invited everybody, and I said, talk for 5 minutes. So, I said to my sisters, I wanted to do the eulogy, you know, I want to tell the stories. And I've done this for a lot of other people. It's crazy. You sit down with the family and you collect stories and you tell their stories for them because they can't do it themselves, right? That's what you do. And I said, well, I'm going to do that. And then I said, hang on, let's make sure we have George to back me up. You know, so, as Craig's son, I just wanted to share some stories of my family life and partner with George to just let him kind of pick up from there and share some stories from your church family life. Because Dad had 2 families. Dad had his nuclear family, his biological family, mom, brothers, you know, aunts and uncles, all that. And he has church family. Now that's been scattered all over the world now. And so George will tell that half, but I'm going to... you can read a bunch about Dad's childhood in the obituary elsewhere, or just, you're going to ask his mom. She's here. But kind of what I want to pick up is in 1959, where Dad entered the family of God, in 4th grade Sunday school class with Jim Selby. And it says in his biography that he wrote this kind of collection of little stories and stuff, that on a Sunday evening, Jim showed the story of the gospel with a wordless book. It was just colored pages with no words in it that explained salvation Jesus offered through grace. And Jim asked Dad if he was saved. And Dad responded with a no. So Jim led Dad towards Christ. And I think that's part of the reason why Dad loved junior boys camp up at Iowa Regular Baptist Camp with 3rd through 6th grade boys driving them crazy for a week, was because he knew that that was a stage of life that a lot of people turned towards Christ as Saviors when he did. And even later in life, in the boundary waters of northern Minnesota, he always said bringing a couple of kids along was entertainment. I think there was a spiritual aspect to it. Kids running around the camp and learning about God's glory from nature. Speaking of being kids, my sister Leah said I was flabbergasted in retrospect thinking how many things Dad did as a father while being a lawyer. You know, just building a law practice and seeming to never miss a piano recital or a flute recital or a vocal recital or a violin recital or whatever thing we were doing that was recited. You know, he was there. He coached our teams. He coached me in basketball. And look, basketball teammates is here today. It's just like, holy cow. Like, it impacted life through coaching. He said he liked the JV girls better, though, because they listened. I just because they won more games. Dad loves crazy experiences. I had no idea he was telling me to shift. Like, I do that kind of stuff, but I didn't know where it came from. But yeah, the crazy neckties, right? He would go to the fridge and pull out all the leftovers and just like put them cold in a bowl together and eat them with whatever sauce he would put on. And about like 6 weeks ago, I was like, okay, what do we got here in the fridge? And I was like, holy cow, I'm my dad. This is it was actually really good. And that's not a bad thing, is it? But each one of us is a little different slice of Craig. And you do some things that you go, oh my goodness, I say that now. You know, like pop providence instead of pop luck. And you know why? Just little things that would do, and he did them all the time, and a lot of times with a purpose to sort of teach you something. And if you have those things in your head, and you're thinking of those stories, and you do them now, because a little slice of it, listen to you, and that's fine. That's good. There's some bad stuff too, I'm sure. Like ice cream at midnight or whatever. But Dad was that's not such a bad thing either. Dad was a family man for sure, and Friday nights were family nights. So Dad would make up these scavenger hunts when we were kids, little kids, and then later we devolved into more like board game tournaments, or just pick us all up and go ice skating with us for the night or something. Just family was a big deal. We always had family devotions around the dinner table, reading the Bible together, reading scripture, praying. And we would go over to the little bulletin board and grab a missionary card, somebody who was serving God in another country, and bring it to the table, fight about who got to do that each day. And we pray around the world. And that's been passed on. And I know we do that for our kids. We do that for our kids. We do it differently. We pull the smartphone and look up the operational world people of the day, and we pray for Djibouti because it sounds funny, you know, or whatever. But we do it differently, but we do it because Dad passed that on. And Dad set a real good example of loving Mom well. And there was no quicker way to get a spanking from Dad than to disrespect Mom. And I know Dad more than wanted us to just respect Mom, but to love her. We saw his love for her for over 20 years, almost weekly. He bought her flowers from wherever it's from his business, and then Hy-Vee, first name basis with the florists. And it was really weird on Monday to bring Mom the flowers for the set of table and go, Dad didn't get to do it this week. And I'm hoping some young boys learn big men things from their daddies that they do for their moms, their spouses, or their kids, so that kind of parenting and marriage is passed on the plane. You learn how to parent your mom and dad where you're sitting by hanging out Sunday afternoon because they tweet it with your kids. I know. They did that for everybody. And of course, the kids, as we got older, he didn't stop helping. Like, he helped my wife and I move to Memphis, Tennessee. He supported Leah visiting her all over the country while she was in the military. He helped us work on our houses. Sometimes the best way was just to play with the grandkids. he had regular and special seasons of just extended playing with grandkids so we parents could just be together as a married couple. And he helped out with legal things. It's like, shoot, now somebody else has to do my taxes. I have to pay them. Helped my wife set up her brown box bakery company in business and advise Sarah all the time in law practice. Blaine, you think you need ministry events every once in a while? Talk about lawyer advice. You know, right? So we're missing for those things. And his care for the extended family went to the kids that are into her. My wife and Stan, fully kids, hung with Stan and playing with the grandkids, conversations about ministry. That's why they sang with us as family, as one of the three families. Like, they were family, we really did adopt them in. So to hear that one of the most delightful things was doing adoptions in a legal sense, he practiced that in his own family. Dad loved history. Oh, hang on, I skipped the story. This is good. So there's this guy that I never knew existed. Dad always said his phrase, you don't have to have a lot of money to live right, you just have to know the right people. And that sounds kind of like using people, but that's not how he meant it. What he meant was, it's not about the stuff, because everyone's got different stuff. They've got a boat, and they've got a place to hunt, they've got a nice comfortable house with kolaches, and it's like, everyone's got different things that they're special about. Be friends with them, share your life with them, and they will share their life with you. And I got to meet Herb and Elsie, because it was Herb's saying, Ann Arbor, New York, I got to meet him going to the game last fall. And the point was this, that family is family in the church and in the community. And giving a sure doctrine back really means what it means. And we know how to fix things on houses. We know how to read for college sports. We know how to do things with cars. We know how to do all those things as kids because of y'all. Dad tried to do those things. And he was one of the people. So that friendship and relationship was important. He loved history, right? Don't ever play Trivial Pursuit against Dad. It's brutal. I remember going up to the Twin Cities and playing with my aunts and uncles, and it's just impossible. You know, all these highly educated people that lived history, and it's like, all right, I'm out. But just always learning on trips, like we go to the East Coast, and it was a traveling history lesson. We go to the West Coast, and it was a traveling history lesson. And whenever we leave the cave, we just kept going to school. You know, Dad, everything that he had belonged to God, all of it. His house, Mom and Dad opened their house for college Bible fellowship, fire-ups, just getting college students over for meals and things. There were times when college students lived with us in our home for extended seasons. There were Thanksgiving meals where it was our family plus extended family plus adopted students from college plus all of their friends, and like 60 people in the house. We knew half of them. And it was awesome. The sledding parties on the Hill of Destruction. My kids don't ever want Mom to sell the house, mainly because of the hill. Kansas is flat. We love all kinds of people in all stages of life, in all stations of life, because that's how it happened. All seasons, all stages, all stations. And the next stage are the grandkids. And we never call them Papa or Nana, that was her, but Papa, Grandmother, the jokes, the tickles, the weed, the pancakes, the sports rivalries, all that. Dad was unique and special. He could have deep conversations, nuanced conversations with highly educated people, and friendly and relevant and caring conversations with people of all ages and all stations of life. And even as recently as this past Labor Day, Dad came down to our big neighborhood party, and I warned Dad, I said, listen, everyone's a BYOB, and so just be ready for that. His dad didn't drink, and that's cool. But he sat down with my new friends and carried on a long conversation about all sorts of things. And they remarked and said, we've never met a guy like that who could talk deeply about so many different subjects and actually know what he was talking about. That was unique. That was really special. I'm grateful for it. It's God's grace that Dad was willing to even relate to anyone. And the fact that you're here and related to you in some way. And that's awesome. That's part of the reason I take the photo. There's too many different kinds of people here to forget that. I read this psalm to Dad in hospice. It says Psalm 145, 1 through 7. I will extol you, my God and King. I will bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you and I will praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised, and greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall commend your works to another, shall declare your mighty acts. And I thought of that the first time in a new way. So I always see this, the old people telling the young people what God's done. And will you older people please keep doing that, because at some point we're going to have to tell it back to you. And we'll have to declare as the younger generations to you, the older generations, how great and faithful God has been to you. And so live that way. And pass on the greatness and the glory of God so that one day those will pass it back to you. And now another generation, who remembers me when I was born, so pick up from there.
I asked Caleb for some elevator shoes so I could speak at his level. You wouldn't have to cross your eyes, but here I am. God's grace was abundant in Craig's life. Craig loved God and his Savior Jesus Christ. He loved his wife and children. He loved God's people, and he loved this church. Craig loved his profession as a lawyer, but Craig's strong motivating desire was that people would know the truth about God and the world as revealed in the Bible. Beginning with his own children, he taught them a love for the nations. All people, of every ethnic background were equal to Craig in Craig's eyes, as he believed that all people were made in the image of God. Craig was an example to his children by supporting the pastors of his church, by taking his children to visit missionaries on the fields, hosting missionaries in the Hastings home, being a host family, as Caleb has already mentioned, to international student dinners, and also serving as an adopted student and friendship family to American and international students. We have students today around the world that have been impacted. Many nations of the world have been impacted by Craig's life. One of Craig's greatest joys was seeing his own children as adults walking in truth, following Christ. Craig believed the local church is God's instrument in this age, and he was faithful and encouraged others to be faithful. He invested much of his life in the church, and this church right here. He served in many ways, as a vocalist in the choir, and as part of a famous, or perhaps infamous, quartet. That's an inside joke. An instrumentalist with his clarinet, and a deacon with this church for many years. When Campus Baptist Church, now CrossRoad, decided to move from Sheldon Avenue, he stepped outside of his comfort zone and became chairman of the fundraising committee for the building. He began the Dare to Dream campaign, and Pastor Albert mentioned that this morning in his message. message with the challenge that we were going to see God do great things within the fundraising effort and that it would knock your socks off. We did see people without socks. And we did see God do great things. God gave us this beautiful building, right, through the sacrificial and generous giving of those people. Praise God. However great Craig's main ministry, as has already been mentioned, in the church was as a Sunday school teacher of the college students. His mantra was, college students can change the world. You've heard that before? He, of course, meant that college students with Jesus Christ can change the world. Craig always tried to think biblically. Sorry, I didn't mention here. He was a self-taught theologian. He really was. He wanted the students to think biblically and challenged them to think theologically and to evaluate the philosophies of the world correctly. He developed a three-year curriculum and rotated through that and serving other courses as he sensed the need. Rejecting the concept that truth is relative, by the way, a self-defeating statement, the first class in the curriculum was on how we know truth. Craig loved to have fun, and he became known for his neckties, right? He always wore a tie as a lawyer and to church. Of all colors and patterns, the ties would always catch your attention. Some had messages. I've been told that the tie that Craig is wearing in the picture on his law firm website has the story of Noah's flood in it. Craig, read the Bible. Sorry. As began to lose stamina, what was later determined to be the tumor, he made one of the most difficult decisions of his life. And he asked to be allowed to step aside as college teacher. Craig has served the students for 35 years. The cause of his weakness was soon discovered, and Craig was in a battle for his health. To celebrate his 35 years of ministry and to encourage and support him in his battle, the church held a special celebration one Sunday. Someone from the community, he may very well be here today, donated a lot of ties, a lot of neckties. And as people arrived at the church, they were offered a tie to wear. People joined together wearing the ties that bind, okay, our hearts in Christian love. As a lawyer, Craig was very generous. I was tempted here to ask you to show of hands here how many of you received some free or otherwise legal counsel, or that was the free counsel here in the aisles of CrossRoad or one of the rooms here. I'm sure many of you would raise your hands. I was meeting with somebody Friday afternoon, three people that were talking about caucusing Monday night, and all three of those people were clients of Craig's. In the 1970s and 80s, Craig gave much time to work for the freedom of parents to homeschool their children or to send their children to Christian school. He was lead or co-counsel on several of the cases in Iowa and was one of the God's instruments to bring about the recognition by the government that children belong to parents and parents, not the state, have a basic responsibility to train their children for life. Craig had begun writing a history of that effort, but was unable to finish it. Many people claim Craig as a fan, as a friend. My family and I have also had that blessing. Craig was God's instrument to bring us to Ames to work in the campus ministry to international students. A missionary friend was speaking at what was named Campus Baptist Church near the campus. Craig talked with him after the meeting and mentioned that there were many international students on the campus across the street, and it would be great to have someone come and serve among them. My friend said, I know someone who's looking for that kind of ministry. We were at that time. After talking with Pastor Alvin the next day, Craig wrote a letter to us, and within a year and 4 months, we arrived in Ames. And who was there? And who was there to help unload the furniture? Craig. Craig wanted us to be here, and he used his hands and his feet to welcome us. There's much more I might say about Craig, Taylor said something about trivial pursuit, okay? I never saw him lose a game. Never did. We who know Craig know he was a good man. We also know that he was not perfect. More importantly, Craig knew he was not perfect. He was only perfect in the area of his counsel as an attorney, right? No errors or omissions. Craig knew that he would not or could not meet God's standard of protection, of perfection. He was trusting Jesus Christ and his death for sin and his resurrection to pay the penalty of his sins. Today, we sorrow for our loss, but we rejoice in the promise of God that Craig is in the presence of his Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. That's our faith, that's our hope, our trust. To him, to God be the glory for all that Craig allowed God to do in his life. Praise God.
Oh,
Michelle. Pastor Charles Albert is going to come. He's a longtime pastor of our church. He's going to come to share some thoughts and some words of scripture as well.
Good afternoon. It's a joy to be with you today. It really is. It's a blessing. I want to share with you two verses of scripture. These verses were the life verses of Craig Hastings. Having received Jesus Christ as his personal Savior, these truths are the truths that he used to guide his life here on this earth. Let me read them for you, man. Romans 12, 1 and 2. I beseech you, therefore, brother, I plead with you, I earnestly plead with you, literally. I plead with you, therefore, brother, by the mercies of God. And for 11 chapters, he's been reciting the mercies of God. And they said, I've got to be careful, Stan, because you're going to give this. But they center in Romans 3, where his sacrificial death that satisfies God completely for all of our sins is the foundation of our being redeemed from sin and therefore being declared righteous as the righteousness of Christ is imputed to us. And these mercies of God, based upon these mercies of God, he says, I plead with you that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. Sacrifice. Wow. That sounds harsh. That sounds strange. That sounds foreign to our worlds today. We don't believe in sacrifice. We believe in what's there for me. What do you mean, sacrifice? This word sacrifice was used in the Greek translation of the Old Testament called the Septuagint. It was used to translate the sacrifice that's called the burnt offering. It's the only sacrifice in the Old Testament where the entire animal was completely and totally burned. It was to symbolize that when we give ourselves to God, we give ourselves completely and totally wholly unto him. Now, when it's all burned up on the altar, you can't take it back. It's a permanent commitment of my life to God. Craig, you need to. And he gave his life that way to God. Present your body as a living sacrifice unto God. Which goes on to say is your reasonable service. In other words, service means active worship. In other words, it's the most reasonable way that you can worship God when you consider all that God has done for. Make sense? Craig, believe that. It should be holy. That means set apart completely unto God. Now, how can we do that? Because we live in a world that is anything but holy. The text goes on to say, verse 2, and do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Now, in English, that sounds like a play on words. Conformed or transformed. But it's not a play on words at all. The word conformed here is a word that refers to a mask. In the Greek theater, instead of putting on a total costume, they would just simply hold a mask over their face. And that mask would represent the character that they were going to play in that play, in that whatever production, whatever it was. And so that mask, as they would put it on, would say, all right, I'm going to be a different person than I really am. I'm going to pretend to be somebody else. In fact, that word for mask became to be used for the word hypocrite. Pretending to be somebody that you're really not. Now what this verse is saying is simply this. don't let this world put its mask on you if you're a Christian. So that you act like, smell like, taste like, sound like, dress like, and anything other than a child of God. But so instead of letting the world put its mask on you as a believer, so that you look or act or taste like someone who's not a Christian, instead of that, be transformed. In other words, transformed means metamorphosis. It's the life that's inside that comes out and dominates you on the outside. You become publicly what you really are. Come out of your shell, take the mask off, and be what you really are. Be transformed, here's how, by the renewing of your mind. All right, Craig, how are you going to renew your mind? You're going to do that by getting into the Word of God. And you're going to do that by prayer. Let me talk about those two things practically. Craig was a great Bible student. He knew the principles of Bible interpretation and he applied them. And he used them and he studied the Word of God successfully and he understood the Word of God fully. And he taught the Word of God carefully and clearly. I asked Kevin. So I talked to him, I said, all right, give me some thoughts about prayer. He said, well, Dad, I don't have to think about that. He said, do it right off the top of my head. Number one, terrible ties. I said, I don't dare say that in this journal. I said, but Laura's going to be sitting right there, and she made most of them. What were you thinking of? But he said, the other thing is, clear teaching of the Word of God. Clear teaching of the Word of God. He knew how to make it clear. He knew how to teach it concisely. He knew how to get right to the point and make it live so that you can understand it. Not only that, he wanted to know God. So he studied the Bible not just to teach it, but to know it, to know God. Because this was God's book, this was God speaking to him, and he wanted God to speak to his heart, to change his heart, to transform his mind, to transform his life. And so he would study the Word of God, and he would learn about God. We call that theology. Didn't that sound dry and dusty? Not with Craig, it wasn't. He was living in Bible because he was growing in his knowledge and understanding of God. He knew his systematic theology. He knew his historical theology. He and I used to talk about biblical theology. He didn't know what that was when I first started talking about it. Take a subject and go through the Word of God. Find out how the Bible develops. And he was good in philosophical theology. He was way ahead of me there. I'm still not there. But he knew God personally. Because he would let God, that knowledge of God, renew his mind to transform his life. Now, if you're going to know God, you're going to talk to him. And pray for him. I'm thankful to God for the hours that Craig prayed for me as his pastor. He prayed for his wife. He prayed for his children. He prayed for his grandchildren before he knew who he was. And he's praying for your grandchildren's children. Now, you have not lost your husband's, father's, and grandfather's prayers. God is still answering those prayers. And he's going to continue to answer those prayers in your lives. Come at it. And teach your children and your children's children that there's a heritage of prayer, a great grandfather who prayed for them and God is still answering their prayers. He prayed for me, he prayed for his family. He prayed for this church. He loved this church dearly. And he prayed earnestly for this church. He poured out his heart to God for this church and for many of his friends
in this church. But that's not all. He prayed for this community. There are people that are here today that Craig prayed for. And you don't even know it. He prayed for you. Some of you that have never received Jesus as your personal Savior, He prayed for you that you would come to know Christ and the wonderful relationship that He experienced. Don't you dare miss it. Let God continue to answer Craig's prayer in your life as well. And then he prayed, as you all already heard, he prayed for the world. He prayed for the world. I wonder how many people are going to enter heaven's portals with Craig because he prayed for them. I'm excited about that. And because of that, Craig was able to prove, demonstrate, show that God's will is perfect, that God's will is acceptable, that God's will can be the best way to live. Here, anticipating how we're going to live with Him for eternity. I appreciate Craig's love for God. The Lord bless you.
My name is Steve Hagen, Craig's son-in-law, married into the family, to his youngest, Sarah. When we come to a funeral, it's a sober reality. It reminds us of what Solomon said in Ecclesiastes, where he said, death is the destiny of every man. The living should take this to heart. In fact, Solomon would say, it's better to be at a funeral, to go into a house of mourning, than to go somewhere where there's this party, in a house of feasting. The reality, it's a sobering thing to be here, because many of you, perhaps your last time, your last interaction with Craig, is probably really healthy. Probably quizzing you in Trivial Pursuit stuff. I mean, Craig was a sharp guy, and a lot of you, that was your last interaction. And now he's no longer here. That should be a sobering reality. In fact, the psalmist will go on and say, teach us to number our days, that we may gain a heart of wisdom. When you understand that life is but a mist, here today, gone tomorrow, as you used to say, it causes you to change, or it should. There's an important question that needs to be asked in these moments that can't be missed on days like today. The reality is you will live forever. I think it was C.S. Lewis who said, I've never met a mortal man. You will live eternally. Now, there's two destinations, heaven or hell. The path to heaven, it's not paved with church attendance. It's not paved with good deeds. It's but through one man, Jesus Christ. John 14:6, I'm the way, the truth, and life. No one comes to the Father except through me, Jesus would say. John 3:6, for whoever so believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Romans 10:9, if you would confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. That's why he died on a cross. If you have not received Jesus and put your trust in him, I would beg you, in light of today, in light of that death is the destiny of man, that you would do that, that you would invite Jesus in and have a personal relationship. But here's the reality is that funerals are not just for kind of that one decision. For many of you, I believe, you say, yeah, my trust is in Jesus. And that might be the majority of the people that are in here. I'm saying there's something that I don't want us to miss. That if you would say that, yep, my hope is in Jesus, I'm a Christian, and I'll get at it like this. Let me ask a simple question. What's the best part about heaven? I'm not going to make you answer it out loud, but if you had to answer that question, when you think about heaven, because right, for those who put their trust in Jesus, When you die, you spend eternity with God. What's the best part about heaven? Now some might say, I bet there's going to be incredible golf courses in heaven. That is an answer. Maybe it's, I'm going to get to see loved ones. Maybe, man, Hickory Park is good, but I can only imagine the food in heaven is going to be way better than that. Those might very well be realities, but aren't they the best part? I was challenged by a young theologian. He said, you know what the best part about heaven is? God's going to be there. God's going to be there. And I don't want to miss it. Oh, yeah, that too. Don't skip over that. Because if your tendency, Christian, is to answer that with, oh, I can't wait for these things. I want to look at our lives right now. Because I think there's a sober reality that we have but just one life. And it will come to an end. How are we spending it right now? And we should take this to heart. And not get caught up with the good gifts that God has given us, but to look at the good gift giver. And to live in light of that. What else is there? And so the reality is if we want to spend eternity with God, and we're saying, yes, that's the best part about dying and going to heaven. What about right here, right now? And I love how Pastor Albert said, to be a person of prayer. If you're looking forward to spending eternity with God, starting a dialogue with Him right now would be a good idea. Opening God's Word. Living like Christ would have us in service to another. And I'm thankful for the father-in-law that Craig has meant to be to show that pattern and to see him finish his life well. I do hope that as we close a celebration of this life out, that it would be a sobering, again, reality for us, that we would look at where we stand in relationship to God, and that is only determined by the blood of Jesus Christ. I want to pray for us, and if you would, join me. Father God, we thank you for the life of Craig Hastings. And Lord, we do want this to be a sobering, gut check kind of day. Lord, that you would help us look at our life, but it's but a mist here today, gone tomorrow. Perhaps the petty arguments were had on the drive over, the things on the to-do list, Lord, would you reorient our lives in light of eternity and in light of the gospel? Would we pattern ourselves after our Savior? Jesus, we do. We want you to be Lord of all. We pray this for your glory. In the name of Jesus. Amen.
beauty of God's grace. It's become as we are. And so Craig came. Hopefully that's how you come as well. If you haven't, we do encourage you to come as you are. God's grace. Through God's word and his promises. We're glad you've come. And we're not done yet. But we're done here. All right. And just so you understand what's going to happen, we're going to pray. Dismiss them and lead the family out the back. And the family, the immediate family, is going to stay right there at the back. And if you need to leave and want to say hello to the family, you are too glad just to wait here for a few minutes and greet the family as you leave. If you can stay for a few minutes, we'd love to have you do that. We have a luncheon in the back. And there's also, if you can see all the video, we're going to show the video in the back. The book will be in the back as well. The memory book, you can sign that as well. So we encourage you to stay. So here's how it's going to work, because we don't want to just have you wait forever, okay? If you want to stay and greet Laura and the family as you leave, then just stay here in the middle aisle. If you want to go to the back and greet the family at the end, as well as participate in the luncheon, just head up the two side aisles and go and head out back to the double doors on each side into the gym. There'll be food out there, and you can just start partaking. And then some of the extended family will be back there already, and you can greet them as well as spend some time fellowshipping together. There's a lot of people who haven't seen each other for a while, so we want to give you a chance to greet one another, and you can do that at this time. All right, let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we come before you. We thank you that you worked in Craig's life. You did not leave him alone in his sin, in his loneliness, but you brought yourself to him through your word and through people who loved him. You gave him a wife who loved him and went with him through life. You gave him a family to provide that joy and purpose and meaning. You gave him a love of you that he was able to pass on to his children, and not just to his children, but to his church family and so many other people. We thank you for Craig. We thank you for the blessing he was in our lives. We thank you that we can know him, and through him, you as well. And also that through him, we can know each other as well. So we pray that you bless our time. We thank you for the people who have prepared the food so that we can enjoy some fellowship together. And we pray that you would bless our time together, and rejoicing in the love that you have for us and the memories we have of Craig. We thank you in your son's name. Amen. All right.